और 33-year-old male patient, Hindu by religion, resident of Kurnool, teacher by occupation, presented with complaints of poor stream of urine since 6 months and incomplete evacuation of urine since last 3 months and increased frequency of urine since 3 months.
Why have you put the Hindu religion here? Dr. Harish,
sir,
answer this. Why
are you Hindu? Sir, if at all it's a Muslim, maybe a peculiar this one circumcision might be done, sir. So we can rule out anything.
What has been done for a Hindu?
Very unlikely, sir. Hindu might not be relevant to this discussion.
Don't put this, Dr.
Sir.
Presentations don't use religion. Okay.
Okay,
sir. To describe it, if you have to, is circumcised male or uncircumcised male.
Okay, sir.
Religion doesn't matter. It can ruffle a few feathers.
So, the post stims in 6 months, only predominant voiding symptoms are present or associated with slower symptoms also? Incomplete evacuation.
See the last 2 lines.
A frequency, how, what is the daytime frequency and the nighttime frequency which
patient was initially last 3 months before.
Hello? Do you have a slide on the frequency?
Yes, sir. In the next slide, I yes, mentioned.
Go to the next slide. Go to the next slide. If he still has doubt, he'll ask you.
Patient initially strained to void completely, but since last 3 months, patients have a sensation of incomplete evacuation of urine and having increased frequency of urination. Initially used to void 5 to 6 times a day, but now he has to void about 8 to 10 times a day. Had he any history of previous urological means?
No, with respect to this,
yes,
if you want to ask him any more questions about symptomatology, ask. History, we should ask them. The next slide might have it.
Yes. Sir, any associated with any suprapubic pain or urgency or urge incontinence or hematuria, anything?
Yes, no. That comes in the rest of the history. They have said he voids about 8 to 10 times a day.
Yes,
is there anything that you would like in addition to what they have given here?
Yes.
Move on to the rest of the symptoms.
What is the frequency in the night as well? Is it bothersome anything in the night?
No.
Two things are important: the nocturnal frequency and the quantity of void.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, let's move on. Next slide, please. Next slide. Who's controlling, Kamal or Hardik?
There's no history of fever, no dysuria, hematuria, or hesitancy or urgency. There is no any periurethral discharge. No catheterization or instrumentation in the past. So this is a 33-year-old male, predominantly with the.
Do you want any clarification, or do you have any comment to make? What they have presented so far.
So only poor flow is there. Other than that,
in this slide, based on what we saw in the earlier slides, is there something here which seems out of place? That it seems an anachronism. His complaint is that he strains toward you, but
yes,
here there is no hesitancy.
Yes, sir.
So when we present, we have to make sure that we screen out all these troublesome terminology. Okay.
Past history and personal history unremarkable, so no contribution.
See, there is something in the history which is missing, which you would have liked now that we have come to the end of history. What is it that is missing? We which the patient may not volunteer, but you will ask.
Any erectile dysfunction along with it. Or any
contact,
and any contact history, sir. But they told there is no periurethral discharge or anything.
Hotels. This is something you are going to do during your examination. But in the history also, it's good to know whether he's had any prepuce leaching, any fissures in the prepuce. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Son is not which a person is who. One son who is 4 years old, which means is inanimate. Or at least not human.
General physical examination, conscious, well-oriented, corneum score 100%. Vitals are stable, sir. And
before we go to the examination, what are you thinking of right now?
Maybe a stricture disease, sir. Because
only one diagnosis?
In the middle age, 33-year-old, maybe a BXO with stricture diagnosis, with a stricture, sir.
Yeah, so because I wasn't happy with only stricture, I wanted any other diagnosis that you've thought of.
Can you be anything else? BXO with stricture? Anything else?
There is no contact disease, sir, or else a sexually transmitted disease can also cause a stricture.
No.
Inflammatory.
Dr. Hari,
yes, sir.
You can't make general statements like this. We are asking for diagnosis. We are not asking of causation.
Yes, sir.
So, you said stricture. BXO with stricture.
Yes, sir.
And anything else in a 33-year-old male present with these symptoms?
Yeah, so any other differentials, or we should think only of stricture?
Vesical calc can also cause poor flow, sir, but it will be associated with intermittency and maybe associated with supraphyseal pain and hematuria, but that is not there yet, sir. So that.
Okay, so one possibility is a vesical calculus. History may be slightly different.
Yes, sir.
What's wrong with BPH?
It's a young age, 33 years, so very
you don't get BPH at 33?
Usually at around 45 years of age, it's
been reported. Large median lobes at 25 years. He's asking you for differential diagnosis. Your diagnosis one was stricture. BXO is the reason for stricture. Simply, I mean, gonococcus is reason for stricture. Apart from stricture, now you've got to think out of the box. You've got to think of something that doesn't exist. Maybe there, you don't know. How do you know? He's an obese fellow. He's 84 kilograms. Obesity and BPH are linked together. Yeah.
That is also.
Nobody can say that he cannot have BPH at the age of 33 or whatever his age is. Yeah. They were well reported. Young BPH. Okay.
And prostatitis can also cause it, but dysuria is not there. So,
prostatitis does not present like this, at least not acute prostatitis. But sir gave you a hint. If the prostate is at fault at 33, what should you be your differential diagnosis?
And there may be other conditions at the age of 33 which can affect the prostate, not necessarily BPH. What?
Don't.
You can't say you don't know, man. How can you say you don't know? Think, man.
There can be a primary bladder neck obstruction, sir.
At the age of 33, we've seen these fellows complaints.
Okay, so primary bladder neck obstruction. Now, we are saying bladder outlet obstruction. Could any other group of diseases present with similar symptoms?
Dysfunctional voiding can also present.
It's not dysfunctional voiding. Please use correct terminology.
voiding dysfunctions.
Due to?
Voiding dysfunction, there are various dysfunctions where maybe neurological as well as non-neurological. In that case, maybe underactive or overactive also. Overactive blood.
He doesn't have symptoms related to overactive blood, isn't he?
Yes.
So how can you say underactive as well as overactive blood? You have to make some judgment call on what he has right now.
Maybe underactive bladder.
Then stick to that, because you are more in line with that. And then you say overactive bladder when there's no urgency, frequency, anything of that. No, you can't. It doesn't gel. But poor stream, yes, gel with hypocontractile, underactive detrusor. Yes. Okay. Anything else? Under the category of voiding dysfunction, Dr. Mohan said, is there anything in the history that you might have wanted to ask him?
Detrusor sphincter dyssynergia, sir. But
careful. Detrusor sphincter dyssynergia, don't use that word in front of urodynamic pundits like Mohan and all that. They'll throw a fit.
Dr. Harish,
yes, sir.
Let us assume we've done all examination, all investigations. Everything is normal. But his symptoms are persisting. Would you like to ask something more in history which will point you to a certain line of thinking, a certain diagnosis, and maybe a certain line of investigation?
Is there any connection between voiding and non-urology organs? Non-urological organs in that area, what are they? Which in some manner may be connected to voiding.
The pelvic floors.
There's only one organ there sitting behind. What is it?
Rectum.
Rectum, yes. Is there some connection between voiding and bowel and everything? Huh?
In case of neurological, this one, they may be, I have a chronic constipated.
Doesn't have to be an obvious neurological pathology. My colleague Dr. Shom, who came yesterday, he's been constipated for the last donkey's years, ever since I've known him in Delhi. He's 81 years old. He's still having voiding problem. He recently did surgery on his anus and he went to retention. So, well known people. And so, the history that you asked for, is there anything wrong with them? Don't forget, anybody with LUTS, just blindly think of bowel also. Have that up your sleeve and make sure you ask that history and don't ask it casually. Because for him, that is what is normal, but that is not normal. You got to probe him. You got to probe him and ask him how exactly is his defecation? Twice a day, three times a day, once in 2 days, is it small, is it large? All of these. Has there been a change recently? All those things. No. Has there been a change in his lifestyle, his diet, something? God knows what he's doing. So these are important questions that you need to ask in any young person who's got voiding LUTS, when you haven't been able to nail things. He may not turn out to have a stricture. Okay, while that's there, you have to think of all these other possibilities in the patient. Okay. Don't forget it.
You could run through this and if you're okay, we'll move on to the next slide. You have to tell them, Dr. Harish.
Yes, sir. Local examination, external urethritis, meatus normal, views retractable.
Okay, I want to ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
Supposing you want to observe the urethral meatus, when is the best time or what would be the best way of a good meatal examination? What would be the best technique for a good meatal examination?
I think I've shown you guys.
Yes.
Ah.
In a supine position, we have to open the meatal response and see the
question
mucosa.
Is to when and how. Question was, when will you examine the meatal and how will you examine the meatal? That's what Mohan asked. Correct, Mohan?
Yeah.
When and how. So both have to be answered. Have you observed sometimes on yourself sometimes, that when you pass urine, that actually it doesn't come, it comes forth. Two streams will come. Patients also will tell you. And then it becomes one stream. Have you observed in on yourself? Sometimes it will come as fork. As the Chinese fellow say, fork tongue, you know, it's forked, it will come like that. Then it becomes one. Why?
As why? The urine progresses, the.
No, why does it happen? Initial. And when does it happen? That then help you to answer the question that Mohan asked.
Initially, there will be a resistance, sir, for the urine flow, and as the.
Is there resistance? There is no stricture there. Remember, we are all men. There will be some discharge, there will be something under the prepuce, and there may be some seminal fluid, some urethral discharge. We are stuck there. It's all sticky stuff. We are stuck at the meatus. You know, it doesn't bother, it doesn't hurt, it's not a discharge anything. But when you pass urine, it comes like then it becomes one stream. It also happens in patients who have had hypospadias surgery or any procedure on the meatus, because we have created a new meatus. Patients always tell you, sir, it's coming like one fountain, it's coming like a garden, watering can. You need to settle down. You have to just reassure. That's because you have created a meatus which is not normal. So now you tell when you want to examine the meatus and how you will examine. This is a clue. When will you examine the meatus?
There is no discharge.
There is no discharge.
After the maturation and
immediately after, no. Technically speaking, you should examine it before you have a baseline, and then you examine it after. The reason is very simple, that you want to know whether the meatus is supple at all or not. Next time you look at the meatus, the meatus is a slit-like opening. You press it anterior-posteriorly, you'll see it opening wide like a fish mouth. It'll open. Next time you examine the meatus, you put two fingers on either side of the meatus and evert it as though you're everting your eyelid. And you'll be able to see right inside, and you see a good meatus, it'll be nice and red. You'll be able to see the glands, everything right, nice and red. And sometimes patients will tell you, sir, I'm seeing something red, because they're doing this all the time, some crazy fellows. So this is a normal meatus. You have to examine it in this way so that it indicates the suppleness of the meatus. It also indicates whether you can see BX of meatus or white inside. Before you do cystoscopy, you won't be able to do this eventration of the meatus. Try it next time. You'll see.
See, the trigger for my question was that the description of the preputial skin comes after the meatal examination. You would normally examine the meatus with the prepuce retracted.
Yes, sir.
You don't want that falling over and obscuring your view. So even when you present, the preputial retraction comes first and then meatus next, with all the other caveats that Dr. Ganesh has covered about how to look at the meatus and what you expect in a normal meatus.
Yes, sir.
They said the bulbo cavernous reflex is normal. How do you test the bulbo cavernous reflex? Everybody writes this, but I'm yet to see people do it correctly.
And that is also written after the DRE findings.
Come man, how do you do VCR? Forgot, huh? It's a test that is not usually taught in MBBS because everybody is shy of looking at that region. Nobody wants to touch the perineum at all in MBBS, not even from anatomy days.
We have to put the finger in both in the anal as well as initiate the reflex from the bulbus. By
so, how do you do that? Bulbus means what? Bulba urethra?
Means penile from the.
The penis extends from the meatus right up to the penis.
From the glands.
Huh?
From the glands or.
So, what do you do to the glands? Stare at it. Huh? Then what do you do to that glass?
Huh? You have to squeeze,
squeeze the glass. And then what do you do with the other finger?
Other finger which is present in the anal canal, which appreciates the contraction of the anal
So is the reflex in one part or two parts?
One is the upper end, sir, which the glands...
No, the reflex arc has to be completed. You have an afferent arc, which is your... If you are a right-handed fellow, you use your left hand to squeeze the glands. And if you are a right-handed fellow, you will have your right index finger in the rectum. But this whole reflex has two parts. As a reflex... this test has two parts to it. One part is that Kerala actress who winked. Remember that girl, no? That wink caused a lot of problem, no? The Kerala actress. I don't know. It's called anal wink. The reason is, sometimes, when you put your finger inside the rectum, number one, if there is spasm, he'll kick you. For some other reason, you know, maybe having a fissure, he said, you don't know. But, when you put your finger in the rectum, you will stretch that anal sphincter and you may not be able to appreciate it. So that's why the exercise is done in two parts. One is, in good light, you have to see the dark hole in the perineum. You squeeze the glands and you see this thing winking. It's called the anal wink. If you find that, that's fine. The advantage of putting your finger inside the rectum is also twofold. One is you are able to appreciate the squeeze. At the same time, you can tell this fellow to squeeze in a finger to take this test the pelvic floor screen. So you kill two birds with one stone by doing that mechanism. Get into the habit. So you will not miss it. You see next time, look at all these things. This case may not be very important, you know, question that one has asked, the BA test. Look at it every day now. Every day you're seeing men in the OPD. Just casually. And make for yourself an idea as to how the BA test will or should look. You know, just see. It takes 10 minutes, to, less than 10 minutes to have a look at this. So now you know how the VCR is done. It's both a visual as well as a palpate.
Serum creatinine is 0.95. Other blood parameters are normal. I would like to have a Euroflow of this patient.
Yeah, you're happy with this hemoglobin, 17 grams.
13 to 18 is their reference value.
Mm-hmm.
Would you be worried if you got a patient whose hemoglobin was 17? Would you be worried? Or you would say, very good, damn good. You're all right.
Maybe a chronic smoker also, sir. In that case, HP.
What's the reason? Are you happy, unhappy?
Unhappy, sir.
You're unhappy. Now, I'm going to ask you a little bit of medicine, not too much. Supposing you found this patient came with a report, would you do any additional examination?
It may be for polycythemia, sir, but...
No, would you do any additional examination, physical examination? Which we might have overlooked initially. Whatever reason, including his complexion, but now he's come with a hemoglobin of 17.
Maybe clubbing, sir.
Are you? Yeah, go on. I think you had something there.
Maybe clubbing, sir, which may be also.
One, you look for clubbing. What else will you look for?
If his bilateral hair entry is good or.
Come on. Clinical examination. Would you look at his nails? Would you look at his tongue? Would you look at his sclera?
For
evidence of polycythemia.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Clubbing is because it will give you a hint that the cause might be something more serious than what we think, smoking or this or that. Other than smoking, let us say this person is a non-smoker, what else can cause the hemoglobin to go up?
You're asking about this particular patient, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. Something there in this fellow. which you commented upon early on when they did the, they gave you all the findings and, you know, general examination and all that. Try to link one of those findings with this. As a result of that, something else could have happened and blah, blah.
His general physical examination was normal findings. Nothing was. General physical examination as well as systemic examination, nothing, no contributor. History was only poor flow is there, other than that.
He's a Slim Jim,
huh? Obesity.
Huh? 84 kilogram, man. Can you link that with this?
Obesity usually may result in this snoring, sir, in the nighttime snoring, which may cause hypoxia. Then it, hemoglobin may rise.
This fellow could be having COPD, may not necessarily be a smoker. We could have that, and that could shoot up the smoker. So there are reasons why this fellow, so, you know, while we are all very happy, he's a well-fed, hatta-hatta young individual, we have to be aware of some of these things when we just glance over some investigations.
Even in the history, if you find this, you will want to ask him about his job. He might be working in an environment full of smoke. He might be working in a kitchen, he might be running a dhaba, or he might be working in an industry which has a lot of smoke. That can cause this, right?
Yes, sir.
So, sometimes we may have to go back to history when we find something like this. Okay.
Move on.
Urine routine is almost normal, sir.
Why is the appearance hazy?
But other RBCs or WBCs is not there.
Okay. So why is it hazy? The doubt must come to your mind. No? Maybe the technician has cataract. Okay, but see, Dr. Harish, you know, we're asking you this because each one of these can be a trigger to something bigger.
Yes, sir.
It cannot be. But for you to pick up, it's important to say it's hazy, but the microscopic examination is normal and there is no protein.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, let's move on.
It's a Euroflow.
First, look at the curve. You tell us whether you are happy with the way this test has been done. Supposing this is your patient, your OPD, and he comes back from the infirmary room with this report. Will you take this report at face value, or will you want it repeated, want it done differently?
So it is almost, the peak is reaching by around 3 seconds approximately.
So what does
that mean? And it is almost stable at around five.
What does that mean? What does that mean?
Patient has
one. Situation is right, but what is the implication?
There is no hesitancy in this patient, sir.
Okay, hesitancy is one thing, but I would be very unhappy with the way this test has been done. Okay, maybe we'll have a discussion on neurodynamics some other time. Okay, fine. So you tell us the interpretation. We'll go with that. We'll discuss all this some other time.
He has a maximum flow about around 5 ml per second, sir. 5 ml per second with the plateau of the curve, actually, which occurs at the 5 ml. And then his postward, he has spotted around 200 ml in 41 seconds. and his post-void residue is nil.
No, no, they have not said nil.
They have dashed.
Dash nil.
It usually means they have not measured the residue in the flow material.
Yes.
Okay, so don't take it as nil. Okay, let us assume that the post-void really was nil and this is a Euroflowmetry. Would you accept this? Would you want to repeat it? Would you want to give any instructions to the patient if you wanted to repeat it?
If it was nil, then patient is able to void totally. So, but with this,
you have to answer my question.
What will you ask him? What will you ask the patient when you see a flow like this and the resident urine is nil?
Still, he feels that incomplete voiding sensation.
No, no. What will you ask him? What will you ask the patient?
You are satisfied with the flow. Or
who is satisfied?
Patient is satisfied with because it's he is completely vacated.
You won't ask him that.
Just to move on.
Satisfied with anything because he has come to see you. He's come to see you for that problem. But he has produced this trace on the machine. So what do you ask this guy? It's a mandatory question that everybody needs to ask every patient, every urologist needs to ask every patient when he sees this trace, when he sees a uroflow trace. The most important question is this how you are normally peeing? Can you do better? Alright? If he says, this is how it's always been for the last donkey's years, alright. So be it. But if he says that I can do better, you have to give him a shot at being better. So it's very important. You check the volume that he has voided, and if that fits in with the ICS definition of a void that is can be interpreted, fine. He's got a void that is 200 ml, so the trace can be interpreted. So when Mohan asks you, look at that. The volume is okay, so the trace can be interpreted. Is there anything else wrong with the trace that makes it all jugglery? There are he said he will talk about it later, but no. The important thing here is to ask the patient this question. More importantly, when the history doesn't seem to match the story. You got a story there, and you find a trace like this. Then you wonder what else happened. There's a mismatch. So you need to ask these questions specifically of patients.
Can a person who is otherwise voiding normally produce a uroflow curve like this?
No, sir, it produces a bell shaped curve.
No, can he produce? The question is not what a normal curve is.
Yes, sir.
But no complaints. Just because it is in your checklist, you send him for a uroflow and he comes back with this. Okay, we'll take this all up and we'll discuss uroflowmetry and urodynamics. For the time being, you tell us your interpretation and let's move on.
It's possible a stricture disease because it is attaining the plateau at around 5 ml.
No. Please. Very important. Very, very important. Don't look at it and say this is stricture disease. You're not a that you can say stricture disease. We must use the right words in urodynamics.
Maybe
very,
bladder,
very important.
Bladder outlet obstruction.
No, it isn't.
No.
You can't say that also. You cannot say it's bladder outlet. All you can say is it is a poor flow. Full stop. This is a poor flow. It may be obstructed. You cannot say it's an obstructed trace. You have hypogastrectomonas, hypocontractual dead tubes, and a flow like this without any symptoms. He may be passing urine. It's a poor flow, maybe obstructive. It's very important for us to understand the terminology, the words that are used, so that we are all talking the same language when we go for meetings and all. And I'm sorry that when we go for meetings, people lug out their own words and things like this too when we have a trace, you know, which is not correct. The ICS has got very clear definitions and we have to stick by it. So just say it's a poor flow. It requires evaluation. If they ask you what could be the reason, then you say, yeah, it could be this, it could be that, this. Very important, okay?
It is a USG finding with the left kidney almost normal, sir, with the normal size they have not mentioned, but parenchyma and corticomedullary differentiation is maintained, whereas in the right,
funny with the shape of the kidney,
reniform,
both the kidneys in fact
reniform, yes sir, mean shaped.
Why is it so,
sir?
The axis and orientation of the sinus. Why do we have an image like this?
Axis and orientation can't be commented now with the single chomps.
See, A, it could be abnormal. B, it could be something normal. Right?
Yes, sir.
So, if it is normal, if the kidney is normal, why do you think we are seeing this kind of a picture?
All CMD is maintained, sir, but maybe there is a mild hydronephrosis, which is the hydronephrosis.
Vijay is talking about the renal contour and the alignment of the sinus.
Yes, sir. Renal contour is well defined, sir. There is a...
Can you speak up a little, please?
Renal contour is well demarcated, sir. There is
Does it have a reniform shape?
Yes, sir.
But to me, it appears to be globular in shape.
Maybe in the lower pole, only that image is deformed, but otherwise it is appearing as a reniform shape.
Can a normal kidney appear like this during ultrasound? Because a certain type of scan is being done, or a certain technique has been used, or a certain section has been taken. As in other tomographic scans, in ultrasound also, you have a longitudinal scan, you have a transverse scan, and scan through the transverse axis of the kidney, and the longitudinal axis of the kidney.
Yes,
right? In the transverse axis, this is how the kidney is going to appear. But you must be able to pick that out if you don't see a reniform shape.
Yes, sir.
It can be abnormal, in which case you will look for other things. We will come to that maybe later or maybe another day. But this could be abnormal. But you have to see that this renal contour doesn't appear normal.
Yes, sir. Right kidney, again, the renal contour is almost reniform only, sir, but there is maybe a mild hydronephrosis which is present in the right kidney.
You see, you know, when we describe ultrasound, we get the description from outside.
Yes, sir. Clear?
Contour, capsule, cortex, medulla, and the collecting system.
Yes, sir.
So, go in that order. You are unlikely to miss something. Otherwise, you might miss something important, which you know, but you haven't mentioned in the exam, and so you don't get credit for it.
Yes, sir. Renal contour is normal, sir, and renal parenchyma is almost normal.
What do you mean renal parenchyma is normal?
The thickness of the renal parenchyma.
Cortex, medulla, sinus, and then the cortical thickness or the parenchyma thickness.
There is no hypoechoic or any lesion, hyperechoic lesion in the...
I think you're missing the point completely. This kidney, let us say, ultrasound shows a normal shaped kidney with normal orientation in its normal position. The cortex and the medulla can be seen distinctly. The collecting system appears in the central sinus and there are no dilated calyces.
Yes, sir.
What can be seen on the pelvis appears normal.
Yes, sir.
That should be your description.
Yes, sir.
You understand?
Yes, sir.
Is the cortex hypoechoic, isoechoic or hyperechoic with respect to the liver and medulla?
It's isoechoic, sir. With respect to here in the left side, it is...
Will you go and read up normal cortex, ultrasound appearance in various parts of the kidney?
Yes, sir.
You can get very badly stuck here.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's move on.
It's a pre-ward or a post-ward?
They have not said pre-ward, post-ward. They only said bladder.
Bladder volume is on 444, sir. Very distended. But they didn't mention about the palpable bladder in the abdomen examination.
No, that's all right. Does the bladder appear normal? Here again, we look at the shape of the bladder, bladder contour, bladder wall, content of the bladder, and any surrounding structures, it might be visible or may not be visible.
Bladder is well distended and the bladder wall appears smooth, sir.
Okay.
Overly distended.
Is there any wall thickening?
At the 444, we can't comment on the bladder wall thickening. So it has to be around 300 ml or 200 ml to comment about the bladder wall.
Even at 444?
Yes, sir.
See, I think you're missing the point, Dr. Harish. If the bladder is thickened at 444, it
yes,
means there is definite thickening.
Yes, sir.
Okay?
Yes,
sir. Only if the bladder wall appears normal with a whole distended bladder, you say, no, I want to look at a bladder at normal capacity.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So, don't become argumentative, but look at this and say, in this film, what do you think? You can then tell the examiner, no, I want to do this again with the bladder less distended.
Yes, sir. The bladder wall appears normal, so not thick at this volume at all.
Okay, you think it's normal? Okay.
Yes.
Contents
are clear, sir. There is no echoic shadow.
Anything else? Is there a stone? You said vesicular calculus. Is there a stone?
No, there is no hyperechoic.
That's all part of the description. Okay, if you run through it, you can progress in the case discussion. Otherwise, we're going very slow.
There is no
vesicular. Okay, let's see the report, please.
Is there a mismatch between this ultrasound of the bladder and some other investigation that they have shown? Is there a mismatch?
Yes, voiding 200 ml.
Right. He's voiding only 200 ml. Is there, could you make some inference? It may not be correct, but you know, you've got a bladder which has got a volume of 400. He's not doing that. But when you ask him to pass urine, the fellow passed only 200.
It's probably in the...
Is there some indication that there was one figure that was missing?
Yes, post-ward PVR was missing from that uroflow.
Possible. There's a huge mismatch between this bladder volume and how he is pissing the machine. And if he says that that's how he's normally doing it, he's only passed 200 ml, so he got the urge at 200. So there must be, he may be carrying a rescue, we don't know. But you know, it's worth looking at all these investigations. Don't look just at the ultrasound, the bladder, and try to correlate one image with some finding. Something is there, you know, we have to try to fix the jigsaw puzzle here. You may not be able to give an answer at this point, but get the pieces right. Then you can fit them into the slots wherever it is. Have you seen how these detectives work in the US and all that? They put everything on the board, whatever, everything, cut, cut, cut. Then they put it on the floor. They put it all on the floor and they put it like this and all that. You see, that's how they work. So the jigsaw is there. We have to fit it. This medicine is a jigsaw, this story. Carry on, man.
Right. The right kidney is showing mild back pressure changes. Left kidney appears normal. So, urinary bladder, it's a post body is around 300 ml.
Mm.
And prostate.
So, he's got a high PVR, isn't it?
Yes.
Mm.
With the slight PVR on the right side. But the serum creatinine is normal.
Alright.
Normal serum creatinine.
Harish, you don't wait for the next slide. Tell us what you want next.
Next, I want to like to have a RGMC user for this patient.
Quickly.
This RGU, which is showing a well distendable urethra up to the bulbar bulbar cones, further the ascent of the dye is not appreciable.
Can you see the bulb? Can you see the bulbar urethra?
Yes, sir.
You can. Is it properly formed?
No, sir. It is not properly formed.
It's not a nice boat shape. Why is it not properly formed?
Yes, sir.
And is it tapering at its proximal end?
Yes, sir.
It is tapering. Are there any irregularities either in the penile urethra or the bulbar urethra?
There's no irregularities in the penile or the bulbar.
Are there any filling defects?
No filling defects, sir.
No filling defect. Can you see the contrast entering the prosthetic urethra?
Very minimal contrast, sir, which is entering. No contrast. No contrast entering the prosthetic urethra.
Well, you look at the film on the right side, you can see a streak of contrast going beyond the bulb.
Yes, sir.
True that we can't see it entering the prosthetic urethra. Maybe not enough was injected, but we can see that. Okay. So, what do you want to do next?
So I want to have a MCU film also, sir.
You want an MCU? Right.
It's a cystogram which shows the well-distended bladder with a smooth bladder mucosa. And the bladder neck is not opened at present. And you want to have
cystogram, you don't expect a bladder neck to be open.
We were talking about terminology. So you cannot say smooth bladder mucosa here. Be careful with your words is what you're being told.
Smooth bladder walls.
Anything more important? What else do you see or don't see?
There is no VOR on either side, but the patient has to ask. There is no VOR, sir, on the either.
Any other one more structure that you should be looking at and commenting on? Can I say with certainty?
It's a cystogram, sir. We have to have a voiding phase.
No, no. Well, you can see contrast even when the patient is not voiding. In which condition do you see that? One which is common in males and another which is common in females. In males with stress incontinence, you might see the urethra filled with contrast.
Yes, sir.
In males, when do we see that? When the patient has overflow incontinence, we have distended the bladder so much, if he has overflow incontinence, some contrast will be seen in the urethra.
Yes, sir.
Important to mention that there is no contrast in the urethra.
Yes, sir.
So we have shown you, okay, you want to see the rest.
So, MCU showing prostatic ಹತ್ರ ಬೆಳ್ಳಿ bladder neck bladder well distended and bladder wall appears normal.
No, bladder wall. In the bladder, what are you looking at in AMC?
Bladder neck is quite open, sir. And bladder neck is quite open. The posterior.
Don't say wide open. We say bladder neck is funnel.
Okay.
Normally funnel.
Yes.
Okay.
Prostatic urethra is well defined and dye can be traced up to the distal bulbar. This one there is a constriction just where the in the bulbar urethra, sir. But
bulbar junction.
Well,
right?
Yes, sir.
Can you go back to the RGU, please? Yeah, here we are not seeing anything.
Yes, sir.
How do you explain this? Yeah, let's move on. Move on. We have seen. Yeah. How do you explain this?
Sufficient. Sufficient amount of dye might not be injected.
No, but you have seen the bulb delineated nicely.
Yes, sir.
The contrast goes beyond the bulb on the RGU. Why do you think? And secondly, if there isn't sufficient contrast injected, it will appear narrow. There won't be a constriction.
Yes, sir. Patient is able to...
What kind of urethral abnormality may we find that the urethra is normal on a retrograde urethra gland, but there is an obstruction on a maturity urethra gland?
There may be a mucosal flap which is there, sir, which...
urethral abnormality.
What is that flap called?
Supposing it's a child...
Child posterior urethra also, but yes. Child location is...
It's always like that, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
We may be able to push the retrograde contrast, but when voiding there is an obstruction which is, you know, can there be anything else similar? Related to the bulbar urethra or the bulbar region, where retrograde is normal, but the voiding urethrogram shows a constriction or a block.
If there is anterior, sorry, if there is posterior, there must be anterior, no? If there is a posterior, there is an anterior. You talked about posterior urethral valve. Is there an anterior urethral valve? Heard of it? No. Huh?
Pediatric urology in Campbell, please read the urethra.
Yes, sir.
Urethral anamnesis. So what do you want to do now?
I want to do a cystoscopy, sir.
What is your diagnosis?
Oh,
give us a diagnosis. You got all the tests done now. You tell me what you think is a diagnosis.
Possibly,
No, tell me, what is the diagnosis? As urologists, we would love to do a cystoscopy, isn't it? On anybody. But before you do the cystoscopy, you must have some idea in mind.
The patient is going to ask you,
what
do you think it is? Why do you want to do cystoscopy? What is wrong?
Confirm
diagnosis we should have.
Let's suggest a mucosal flap which is there, or
mucosal flap. Tell us
the mucosal flap. Is it one side or all?
Circumferential.
So then what is it called?
Somebody has given you the answer, doesn't matter, right or wrong, you mentioned that answer. Dr. Ganesh gave you the answer a couple of minutes ago.
Anterior.
Yeah, it could be an anterior urethral valve or it could be a stricture.
Yes, sir.
Correct. So why the hesitation? Can it be a tumor in the urethra?
33 years.
No. Urethrogram wise, can it be a tumor in the urethra? A polyp or something?
Yes, sir.
Well, the urethrogram, do you think it's a polyp? The polyp is usually seen towards one wall, gives
a
filling defect, right? Here it is 360 degrees. It can't be a polyp. It may be a stone, but unlikely because we don't see any meniscus sign. And on retrograde, we've seen the urethra appears normal.
Yes.
So these are the differential diagnosis for a urethral obstruction. If you had any instrumentation, then we can think of flap and diverticulum and this and that. But he's not had any instrumentation.
Yes.
Do you read Sherlock Holmes?
No. No time.
I thought you might have read it in his school days.
Amar Chitra Katha. You see, there's an
impossible. Impossible has been ruled out. Whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth.
Just give me the RGU and MCU. This is the important finding here which we can't gloss over. If you look at the RGU, there are two films, isn't it?
Yes.
And both of them, one has shown that there is no contrast going up and the other has shown a streak of contrast. Now, if you look very carefully, the normal bulbar cone is a cone. It is not round, it is a cone shape. It goes like a cone, like that, and goes inside. If you look very carefully, okay, yeah, it's not true, but you know, it's not really a cone. It's not really, really a cone. Then you go back down the voiding. You see the voiding carefully.
Where is the level? Here also you must look at anatomical levels.
See the voiding. Two films have shown identically that there is a gap. That there is a gap. Now, when somebody voids with large volumes of urine inside, the urethra is like the pelvic floor distance, the urethra is mobile, it comes down. And this fellow is a fat guy, so his perineum must be fat. And you see that whatever contrast has come from the blood neck, open the posterior thra, open this bulb, it has, this much of contrast has still not been able to go through that. Why is it like that? So much. He's not able to open that small little streak also which we saw going into that thing. Therefore, on balance, this guy most likely has a stricture. Putting these investigations together, so that's how you will argue the case in the exam. See, because of this and because of this, my bet is on this. We are wrong. We are all human beings. But whatever we are given in, we have to look at these images very closely and study them very carefully. So, he doesn't have to have BXO. He doesn't have to be sexually active. I mean, he doesn't have to be going spring around. 30% of strictures in the urethra are idiopathic. We don't know how they happen.
What is the other unusual thing here? The voiding pillar.
He's able to void.
So many MCs you see now.
What was done? He wants his cystoscopy. Has it been done?
Manish?
Hardik will have to tell us, sir.
No, sir. Not done, sir.
Not done, Hardik.
Hey, not done, sir.
Don't bring incomplete cases, please. Because Dr. Harish is going to go back disbelieving everything we have said so far.
Anyway, tell us next week.
Okay,
sir. The anterior urethra beyond the stricture is also well distended. What could be the reason for that, sir? The complete annular narrowing there. But still the anterior urethra is well distended beyond that.
You said these are some points of interest. You see, have you heard of a term called an ED? Or a, what's it called? It's called a post-stenotic dilatation.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
So some of these things could explain it, which is why for the anterior urethra, we mainly look at the ascending urethra graft. Because that distends the anterior urethra very well, unlike a micturating urethra graft. Based on what we find there, we combine our findings there with what we see on micturating urethra graft and arrive at diagnosis.
Okay.
So if you've asked for an RGUMC, you never make a diagnosis simply based on RGU, however obvious it might be to you. In the exam, say I want to see the MCU also. It's not unusual to find strictures at multiple levels. It's not unusual to find BPH with stricture. It's not unusual to find other things with stricture, especially a tumor with stricture, which we might find, you know, as a filling defect in the bladder, which we wouldn't have thought of. So look, once the series has been done, look at all of them, and then you can come to your diagnosis and justify it based on what is seen on the urethra.
Yes.
What is the concern in this patient? Now that we've done an RGU, MCU, everything, but we've not done anything more.
It's low, sir. It's high pressure retention.
High pressure.
There's no evidence to say any high pressure.
He's got a residue of 319. Should we do an SPC?
It's voiding well, sir. Yes.
Sorry?
Voiding well. You can't say voiding well. That's why he's come to you. He's not voiding well. He's come to you with problem of poor flow. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
That's his main problem. So you can't say he's voiding well.
He's got unilateral hydronephrosis.
Yes.
He's not voiding well. He's got a large residue. Residue is 319. So do you want to do an SPC? Awaiting definitive procedure, diagnosis and definitive procedure. In other words,
yes,
in bladder outlet obstruction, what are the indications for doing an SPC prior to definitive procedure?
If, you have a fellow in the ward right now.
If
a doctor.
If there is a deranged serum creatinine or electrolyte imbalance, is there?
Electrolyte imbalance, yeah.
Because of the serum elevated serum creatinine.
Renal failure with nephrosis accepted.
Okay.
Elevated creatinine.
Then what else?
Then if he is in
there. There was a comment made about this fellow's urine. Dr. Mohan said something. He said cataract. That fellow may have cataract.
AG, if it is a recurrent UTI, if it's in the UTI, if he is in the AU.
If there was evidence of urinary tract infection, there may be, he may be asymptomatic,
yes,
but there could have been evidence that there could be debris inside the blood. All right? The urine is hazy. The fellow's urine could be smelly. Isn't he found? It's not that he said. You ask the question sometimes, some astute patient will give you the answer. These would be indications that, well, this higher residue is needs to be sorted out. Or if this fellow is having incontinence, leaking urine. He's disgusting, his job, his underwear, his pants, everything are getting wet.
See, and in overflow incontinence, he has no way of controlling it.
Yes, sir.
Understand? So, specifically, person with overflow incontinence. Bilateral hydroerythronephrosis with or without renal failure, urinary tract infection, overflow incontinence, or painful retention.
Yes, sir.
These would be the indications for doing an SPC.
Very good.
are there any disadvantages in doing an SPC? Let us say patient has got a stricture and we want to do an SPC. Are there any disadvantages?
Urethra may close, sir, because it will be in the urethral rest.
Urethra want to close. Urethra remain open. After all, the SPC is not going to be there for years together. Can it pose any difficulties during urethroplasty? Or can there be a disadvantage?
In this case, no disadvantages.
Right? We need to think of all this because the decision to do an SPC is not a simple one.
Yes, sir.
Then, of course, there are multiple questions that come up, like where to do an SPC, at what level, and so on. Anything else from anybody? Dr. Prabhakar? Any questions? Or comments, sir?
We'll be interested in the findings, endoscopic findings.
Yeah, yeah. I think next week you're going to tell us.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Oh, come with the video of the endoscopy, okay?
Why did patient come?
Okay, sir.
Is the patient with you or has he gone home?
He's gone home, sir.
That's why
I said, try calling back.
Yes, sir. Plan for cystoscopy, sir. Pre-op investigation, plan for corona test, sir.
Where is this fellow from?
Sir, plan for corona test, sir. Every Wednesday and Saturday, we are doing corona test. So, their turn will come on Saturday, sir.
I hope somebody in Anandpur has not already and done something on his urethra.
See, that is from your place only.
Okay, then, thank you, folks.
Thank you.
Just about overshot time, we'll catch up next week. And Hardik will tell us the findings of the cystoscopy. Show us the findings of the cystoscopy. Okay, thank you all. Have a nice day and a good week.
Thank you, sir.